There's been a lot of speculation about cryptocurrencies. Are they the future of finance or just another fad? These digital assets have divided the investing public and even the academics who study them. The one thing we know for sure, they've made some of their founders and early investors spectacularly rich. This series gives you the chance to hear from some of the most influential people in the crypto space. In this episode, we talk to Leemon Baird, the computer scientist behind a technology called Hashgraph. In this section of a longer video, Leemon explains the nuts and bolts mechanics of how Hashgraph works. He also shares his thoughts on distributed ledger technologies more generally. That's the overall category of technologies that powers cryptocurrencies.
Hashgraph is a way of making a distributed ledger work. In other words, it's a way to have a bunch of computers come to an agreement on the order of our transactions, of the things that we're doing. And it also puts timestamps on them. So we have an agreement that this transaction was first and this one was second, not the other way around. And we have an agreement that this transaction happened at noon on Tuesday. And the whole community is agreeing on this. And that's what every DLT needs to do. Every distributed ledger comes to agreement on ordering and timestamps. And that's what Hashgraph does. But it does it in a very strange way, not the normal way of doing things. It is not like proof of work. You do not have to buy a supercomputer to run a node. In fact, we have full nodes that are Raspberry Pis. You know those little tiny $30 computers? My cell phone, of course, is far more powerful than you would need to be a full node. A cell phone can easily do it. So we don't use proof of work. The obvious way of getting consensus is, well, let's just have a king. I mean, that's the easiest way to make everyone agree on something. We'll have a king, and the king decides what we do. That's the simplest way to have agreement. So in a lot of old systems that were designed, and many of the new systems are based on a leader. And in some systems, what you have is one computer is the leader. Everybody sends it the transactions. It puts them in order, and then it tells everybody the official order that it decided on. That's how it works. The problem is, with a leader, you can do DDoS attacks, distributed denial of service attacks. What if there are a bunch of computers out on the internet that a hacker has taken control of? Little tiny computers, like the computers in printers and in web cameras and in DVRs. And they've taken control of a whole bunch of these little computers and they tell all the computers at once to flood the leader with packets. That would shut down the leader, which would shut down the whole network. Now, of course, if they manage to get enough of these bots to shut down every single computer in the network, then the network's dead. But you don't want it to be so fragile that just shutting down one would do it. And so what we want is to have every computer be the same. We don't want one computer being the leader, not even temporarily. There are other ways of doing ledgers. Voting-based systems are 30 years old. The math is beautiful. The guarantees are beautiful. They're really nice. And no one's ever used them, as far as I know, these voting algorithms, because they are so incredibly slow. You have to send gazillions of votes over the internet and receipts on votes, and it just blows up and you can't do it. So to my knowledge, no one's actually applied these in the wild. And then you have Hashgraph, which is none of the above. It's this weird thing. In Hashgraph, here's how it works. We all want to do transactions. You know, my transaction might be to move some money from one account to another, or my transaction might be to store a file in our network, or my transaction might be to run a smart contract, a little program that enforces some rules. So we all put our transactions into the network anytime we want to. Any computer can put in their transactions. And when you have a transaction, you tell everybody else in the fastest way we know in computer science, and the most resilient way we know, which is a gossip protocol. It's used all over the place. You just tell somebody at random, and now two of you know it. And then each of you tell someone at random. Now four of you know it. Then each of the four of you tell someone at random. Now eight of you know it. And it keeps doubling. And so in 10 steps, 1,000 people know it. In 20 steps, 1,000,000 people know it. In 30 steps, 1,000,000,000 people know it. It just explodes outwards exponentially fast. Spreads as fast as gossip spreads rumors in an office. That's why it's called a gossip protocol. Sadly, it does not solve the problem of consensus. All it does is the gossip protocol allows us to get our message out fast, and everybody will get the message. And so all it is when I call you up, I say, so what do you know so far? Oh, here's what I know so far. Okay, I'm going to send you the messages you haven't heard yet, and you send me the messages I haven't heard yet. So everyone's going to get every message really fast, but everybody will receive them in a different order. So I'm now having to send you all my messages, but I'm also having to send you maybe 1% more messages. So I need just a little bit more powerful computer, a little bit more bandwidth. And what those two hashes are is they just tell you, here's my message. Oh, and here's the last message I created and the last message somebody else created who just talked to me. And that's it. Every message has these two lines going out to two previous messages. And each of them has these two lines going out to two previous messages, earlier ones, and so on, and so on, and so on. And when you collect this pile of messages inside your computer, you can just graph them out with all these lines. And what you get to see is a complete history of how we've talked to each other. Not only do you get to hear all the juicy rumors, you get to see exactly how they reached you. In fact, you can tell for any given rumor when each person in the office heard it. Of course, this isn't an office, these are computers. But for any particular one of these messages, you can see exactly when every computer heard it, and in what order they heard it, and in what order they talked to each other. You get this complete history of how we have talked to each other. Okay, that's weird because, well, that doesn't give me consensus either. I don't care about that. What I care about is the ordering. So I had to send the messages out. I do that the simplest, fastest, most resilient way known. It's beautiful. Then I add this tiny bit of information that gives me this weird graph of all of us, how we talk to each other, held together with hashes. We call it a hash graph. It's a graph, which is things connected with lines in math theory, and it's a held together with hashes, so it's a hash graph. Hash is just a way of taking a big message and scrambling it down to just a few bytes. So we've sent the messages out. We've added a tiny bit of extra information just to get the hash graph. And now we're going to get consensus by running one of those really old algorithms, 30-year-old voting algorithms that require gazillions of votes to go over the internet. But we're going to do it with no votes. Zero votes. We're going to use virtual voting. In other words, you have to send the messages out. You have to send a tiny bit more information, and then you get consensus for free. You send zero more information beyond that. Wait, how could you do that? It's because of the hash graph. We can see the history of how everyone talked to everyone. So I know what you know. I know when you knew it. I know what you know about what Alice knows, about what Bob knows. I know everything about what you're thinking right now, and so I know that if we did run one of those 30-year-old algorithms, if we were to take one of them off the shelf and run it right now, I know how you would vote. So don't bother sending me your vote. I'll just run it in my mind and pretend that you voted. And so I can run one of those algorithms that had the really strong proofs, asynchronous Byzantine fault tolerance, but I can do it purely in my head at zero cost over the internet. No messages whatsoever, no bytes whatsoever over the internet. And it happens very, very fast. And so what we're talking about is when you do a transaction, everybody gets it as fast as we can push things over the internet. I don't think you could get the messages out any faster. We pay a penalty of 1% in the amount of extra data we've sent, so we basically still, everybody gets it as fast as possible. And as soon as you get one of these messages, if you get a few more, you instantly know how fast this one is, or where this one goes in history. So when you get a message, a transaction, you get a few more that you collect, and then when you just get a few more, you will know for sure where in history this one goes and what the timestamp was on it. Guaranteed. And it's guaranteed that we'll all have the same answer as long as less than a third of us are being malicious. And it's guaranteed that we'll all get the same answer even if the internet itself is being malicious. If there's DDoS attacks on us, if there's firewalls that are stopping traffic or letting some traffic through and not others or slowing down traffic, doesn't matter. We have guarantees. The strongest math guarantees that we could. And so Hashgraph is gossip about gossip with virtual voting. And that gives you incredible speed. And so you can be doing hundreds of thousands of transactions a second, or you can be doing consensus in a few seconds. That is how Hashgraph works. The idea is that we as a community are going to come to an agreement that this transaction happened at noon on Tuesday. And no one person can unfairly influence what answer we come up with. Basically, what we're going to do is the Hashgraph lets me see so much about our history that I know when Alice received it, and when Bob received it, and when Carol received it. I know when each person received that transaction for the first time, and the time they claim to have received it. And I can just make a list of all those times that everybody says they received it, and sort them in order, and take the middle one on the list. And if less than a third of us are evil, then it came from a good person, from an honest person, or was between two times from honest people. But if you have a stock market, fairness matters a lot. If I put in a bid on a stock and you put in a bid on the stock, if yours was put in a little bit before mine, you want to get credit for being before me so that you get the stock. It is incredibly bad if I, all by myself or by bribing just a small number of computers, could get mine unfairly put before yours, even though yours actually reached the world before mine reached the world. This prevents that. It prevents the unfairness there. And so it's incredibly important for a stock market. It's important for an auction. It's important for a patent office that cares in the order in which the patents come in. It's important for a game. If it's a first-person shooter and you shoot me and I dodge, we care a lot which one happened first. If you shot first, you get a point. But if I dodged first, you don't get a point. And so it would be disastrous if I could cheat and hack the computer on the software on my computer and get my dodge to happen earlier than it really happened. In this system, you have fairness. So it could be used for real-time games, or it could be used for a stock market. So that's what Hashgraph does. It is gossip about gossip with virtual voting. That gives you speed and security, and you get fairness. And those enable all sorts of things for a distributed ledger.
Leemon covered some of the basics about how Hashgraph works. We also learned more about distributed ledger technologies more generally. What are their strengths? What are their weaknesses? And perhaps most importantly, what can they actually do for us? We're still very early in the distributed ledger tech game. There are many issues that still need to get sorted out, and things are changing very rapidly. But when armed with a basic understanding of how these technologies work, we can all become more sophisticated watchers of this space. For Real Vision, I'm Ash Bennington.